So in this section now, we will be learning the general direction or the sign of delta and gamma for different type of options. Okay, so the general direction or sign for delta and gammas. So that you should be able to appreciate whether a particular position will have positive deltas or negative deltas. So it's very simple as far as deltas are concerned. So if you have a call option, if you have a call, then a call option delta is generally between 0 and 1. So that's the range for a call option delta, 0 and 1. If you have a put option, if you have a put option, the range for a put option is between minus 1 and 0. So call option is between 0 and 1, put option is between minus 1 and 0. But the sign of the put option delta or call option delta also depends on which direction you have built position on. Okay, so a very easy way to approach. Let me write down the heading here. These are deltas. A very easy way to approach this is to look at basic option flow chart. Okay, so if you remember in one of the earlier sessions when I did basics of options with you, I did this flow chart. So I said options, we can either have calls or we can have put options. Within call options, we can have long position or short position. Within put options, we can either be buying put options long or we can be selling put options short. Now, if you're a long call option, are you bullish or bearish? If you're a long call option, are you bullish or bearish? Your bullish. If you have a short put option, if you have a short call option, bullish or bearish? Bearish. How about long put? Bullish or bearish? Long put. You're bearish again. And short put, you're bullish, right? So very easy way to kind of remember this is BBBB. The first position and the last position in the flow chart are bullish positions, and the two in the center are bearish position. Now, if you remember this, then more or less your option delta job is done. Because if there is a position where you have built long call, so a long call position is going to have positive delta. Long call position is going to have positive delta. And if you have a short call position, then it is going to have negative delta. If you have a long put position, it is going to have negative delta. If you have a short put position, it is going to have positive delta, right? So the easiest way you want to approach this, let me just copy paste this. The easiest way you want to approach this is just ask yourself, are you bullish or you're bearish? Because whenever you are bullish, the delta position that you're going to have is always going to be positive. If you are bearish, the delta position is going to be negative. So look at this. A put option is supposed to have a negative delta, right? Minus 1 and 0, 1. So if you buy a put option, buying means long put, you have a negative delta. But if you're selling a put option, if you're selling a put option, then your delta becomes positive. A call option is supposed to have a positive delta. So when you're buying a call option, you have positive delta. But when you sell a call option, it becomes negative. So that's where it gets very complicated. Therefore, what I want you to do is just remember this: B, BB and B. Bullish, bearish, bearish, bullish. If you remember this, you do remember the direction of deltas. The first one, last one, positive delta. The two in the center are negative delta. Is this clear? Have you understood this? Okay. Now, how about gammas? Right? How about gammas? When will you have positive gamma? When will you have negative gamma? So there is a very easy technique. Imagine we have two individuals. You know, let's say we have an individual here who's this guy is some sort of a consumer, right? So he is some sort of a buyer. And imagine we have a shopkeeper. Okay, so this is, let's think of this as a shop. And let's say the shopkeeper, this guy is the seller. Okay, so this guy is the seller. Now imagine you've gone for grocery shopping. And when you're grocery shopping, you know, let us say you have purchased yourself, this particular item, whatever that might be. But along with this, you get something free. Along with this, you get something free. Can you tell me what do you get free when you buy something at a grocery shop? Toffee? No. Dhania? Who are those Dhania guys? You get some sort of a kadi patta. Okay, so you get some sort of a bag free. I mean, let's assume you do. Okay, now don't throw those environment regulations at me. But what you do get, and let's assume that this is a bag. You know, this is a bag that you get free, right? So just think of this bag as gamma. That's your gamma. Okay, so it doesn't matter what you're buying. It doesn't matter whether it's a call option or put option. So if you are a buyer, now this option could either be call. This option could either be call or put. Doesn't matter. If you are a buyer of the option, you're getting this back free, right? You're buyer of a call option. So you're going to be positive gamma. Your gamma position is going to be positive. Whether you are a long on call, long on put, doesn't matter. You're buying, you get the carry back free, positive gamma. And you're the seller of the option. Doesn't matter whether it's a call or put. If you're a seller of the option, you're going to have a negative gamma. So that's the easiest way in which you want to approach this. Buyer of the option, positive gamma. Seller of the option, negative gamma. Is it going along with premium direction? You decide however you want to, you know, think about it. Just know that if you're a long on call, long on put, you have a positive gamma. If you have a short, you have a negative gamma. So long is positive, short is negative. Now, let's build on to this a little more. And now we will go to this website called Option Price. And we will try and play around with this. Okay, so let's create a hypothetical example. Let us create a call option and put option with a reasonable expiry. Okay, so we have a hypothetical example where we have underlying price, we have exercise price. In fact, I should keep this a little lower. No, okay, that's fine. So we have underlying price, we have exercise price, we have all this data. Okay, so let me take a screenshot of this. I'm going to put all this into your notes so that when you revise, it becomes easier. Okay, so let's put this as the base scenario. So this is a base scenario. Okay. Now in this base scenario, what I want you to observe, in this base scenario, what I want you to observe is observe what is the current delta of this call option. The current delta of this call option is 0.612, right? Now, how to read and look at the delta of the put option? The delta of the put option is minus 0.388. So put option delta negative, call option delta positive. Now these are for long positions. Of course, if you take short position, it gets inverted. Now how to read this? So the way to read this is, currently the underlying price is 10,000. So right now the stock price is 10,000 and the call option premium, call premium is equal to, call premium is equal to Akrashe Katar 0.925, 1171, 1171.925. Now the delta right now, which is given, is 0.612. So 0.612. Now what it means is, it means if underlying price becomes 10,001, if underlying price increases by 1 rupee or $1, then what will happen to your option price is, can you please help me add 0.612 to this number with all the decimals and put it on the chat box, please. The underlying price will increase by 0.612. So can you please do the math and tell me how much is it? $1,172.537. Okay. That's what delta means. And let us experiment and let us see if that is, that is really the case. So let me go and change this underlying by one. Okay, and let's calculate again. And let's see what we get. We're getting the more or less the same result. We're not getting 100% perfect result, but we're doing fairly close. That's because it's a, you know, it's a derivative, so it works only on infinitely small changes. But let me put this thing here and then you can compare it. See that when underlying is being changed to 10,001, your option price became 1172.532. Our calculation gave us 537, right? So we are almost there. So we are almost there. Why are we not precise? Why not precise? Because it's a derivative. Because delta is a derivative. Delta is a derivative and it works on infinitely small change. That means 1 rupee is a very big change. Ideally, the change should have been smaller, infinitely small changes. Right? So that is how you're going to think of delta. May I assume that you've understood this? Yes, good. Now, this was the delta example. Now let's work a little bit on gamma. So let's do a example for gamma now. So let's build a base case scenario. So I'll try to build a scenario where gamma is a little higher. So let's keep both of them hundred. And let's keep them fairly close to expiry. So I'll probably keep only 10 days to expiry so that gamma number would be higher. Okay. So this is my base case scenario now. Let's put that. Let's put this here. Now, observe what we have. We have a delta of, we have a delta of 0.519 and we have a gamma of 0.096. Okay. So right now spot price is 100 and the current delta of the option is 0.519. Now if underlying asset increases by one, that means if underlying asset will increase by one, then my delta will also increase and my delta will increase by a factor of 0.096. So 0.096. Can you please add that here? Can you please add 0.096 here? So it becomes 0.615. So my delta will increase to 0.615. Observe, both of them have positive gammas, right? Which means when underlying will go up, the delta of both call option as well as put option will increase. Call option, it's a positive number, so of course it goes towards plus one. Put option is a negative number, so it is going towards zero when underlying asset is increasing. Okay, so let's experiment whether that works. Okay, so let me change this to 101 and look at the new delta now. Okay, so let's look at the new delta. Oops. New delta now has become 0.613. So we are almost there. We calculated it to be 0.615. It is 0.613. So that is how you want to think of gamma. And finally, one last part of it. And then more or less our deltas and gammas will be closed. And we'll have, of course, we have to do more advanced hedging, but the basic will be closed. Do you remember ND1 from Black and Scholes? Do you remember ND1 from Black and Scholes? So that ND1 from Black and Scholes was nothing but the delta of the call option. So that ND1 that you saw, that was the delta of the call option. And if you do ND1 minus 1, that means if you deduct 1 from it, then what you get is you get the delta of the put option. Okay. So, and in general, this logic always works. You know, what do I mean by that? So imagine this is a call option and it is a put option. Okay. So imagine a situation where we have a call option, strike price is 100 and let's say a spot price is also 100. So when strike price is 100 and spot price is also 100, is it in the money or at the money? This is at the money, right? So a call option will have a delta close to 0.5. So the same put option, which also has a strike price of 100, it will have a delta of close to minus 0.5. So this 0.5 minus 1 will get you minus 0.5. It's just that it would be a negative delta. Now, if call option delta, so imagine a situation where S is, 180 in our example. So if this delta has become 1, So if call option delta has become one here, okay, so if this is the delta, then for a strike price of 180, for a strike price of 180, this is a completely out of the money put option. So this delta of the put option would be zero. When the strike price is, you know, let us say 40 here, then call option delta will be zero. But for the same spot price, I should have written S here. But for the same spot price of 40, the put option delta will be minus one because it would be deep in the money. So that's how, you know, that's how you want to visualize this. Whenever a call delta is 0.4, put delta will be minus 0.6. A call delta of 0.3, put delta would be minus 0.7. Okay, and hopefully you're getting a hang of it. And with this, our basic discussion of the deltas and gammas is done. Now I'm going to take any questions. Otherwise, I'm going to close this topic and take you to the next one. Of course, we haven't done delta and gamma hedging. I'm yet to take you there. I'm just giving you a brief primer on the concepts. One question I've got from Dimple is, how do trading strategies and speculators use this information? So there are a variety of, you know, different strategies around it, Dimple. I mean, it really depends on, you know, what are you really trying to play with? And I'm not sure if at this level you'd be able to appreciate, but let's say, you know, at times I just want to build a trade on volatility and I want to keep myself delta neutral. So what I can do is I can use a structure where delta of my portfolio is close to zero. I'll try to keep gamma close to zero, but I'll try to build a positive volatility in my portfolio, a positive VIGA, right? So at advanced level of option trading, it's all about option Greeks and how deep you have understanding of them and how you want to build your trades. Do you want to play on VIGA, theta? There are some very gamma, complicated gamma trades as well. But it will probably take us a lot of time to reach there. So one can isolate these. Yes, you can use optimization to minimize exposure to other Greeks and play on one particular Greek. That those strategies are available. Why not greater than one? Not able to grade it. That question is from Shefali. That why option deltas are not greater than one, for the simple logic that the option price can never be higher than the spot price. If you allow deltas to be greater than one, that means option prices are rising faster than the spot price. At some stage, option price will become higher than spot price. And we have learned in minimum and maximum bound that that's a mathematical impossibility. Right, so that simply ensures that your option deltas are between the range of 0 and 1. And I think that's a very logical way of looking at it.